Hey, y'all, I'm Pastor Xavier Jones, lead pastor of Transformation Church. I am excited about what God is getting ready to do in this message today. I just preached a message titled Signs and Signals, and I did a subtopic today titled Safe Zone or Danger Zone. You need to know which one you're in. I want you to watch this message in its entirety. It's going to bless your life. If you're doing anything with relationships, you need to hear this message. I need you to do me a favor. I need you to share this video with your friends, drop it in your group chats, tell someone to be a part. Number two, I need you to subscribe to this YouTube channel. There's some amazing things that's getting ready to come up, and I want you to be a part of it. And third thing that I want you to do today is I want you to prayerfully consider giving to Transformation Church. I want you to generously bless us so that we would have the opportunity to continue to expand ministry. It's through your giving that gives us the opportunity to serve children in our community, to begin to do out-of-the-box innovative outreach. It's through your giving that helps us to be able to advance ministry. We're so excited that right now we're getting ready to start our second location in Homestead, Florida. God is getting ready to move on these individuals, and it's through your giving that gives us the finances to help make it happen. Thank you in advance. The information is on the screen for you to give. Thank you in advance for what you're about to do. I'm excited for the future. So in Jesus' name, I can't wait to see you in the comments.
Is anybody ready for the word this morning? Well, 9:30 a.m. had a whole bunch more, energy than y'all have. I say, is anybody excited about the word this morning? Amen. I want you to grab your Bibles and turn with me to Ephesians chapter number 5. If you have anybody that needs to hear something concerning relationships, they need to be in this service today. So do them a favor and tag them on social media and tell them to jump in. There is a word from the Lord. I came to have a conversation today with you about this particular subject that we're discussing today. Once you have the word, I want you to stand in reverence to God's word. We believe in standing here. We believe that every time the word is being spoken, that it's like Jesus himself walking in the room. So we want to stand in reverence to his word. Ephesians chapter number 5, at verse number 11, it says this. This is a text that we've been using as our bedrocks text. So Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 11, it reads like this. Don't waste your time on useless work, mere busy work, the barren pursuit of darkness. Expose these things for the sham they are. It's a scandal when people waste their lives on things they must do in the darkness where no one will see. Rip the covers off those frauds and see how attractive they look in the light of Christ. Wake up from your sleep. Climb out of your coffins. Christ will show you the light. So watch your step. Use your head. Make the most of every chance you get. These are desperate times. Says, don't, 2 Timothy, I'm going to read from 2 Timothy, chapter number 3, verse number 1. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it for you. Don't be naive. There are difficult times ahead. As the end approaches, people are going to be, I need you to repeat after me, self-absorbed, money hungry, self-promoting, stuck up, profane, contemptuous of parents, crude, coarse, dog-eat-dog, unbending, slanderers, impulsively wild, savage, cynical, treacherous, ruthless, bloated wingbags, addicted to lust, and allergic to God. They'll make a show of religion, but behind the scenes, they're animals. Stay clear of these people. I didn't write this. This is the word of God. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the understanding of your word. Give us power and strength, and we'll forever give your name the praise, both now and forever. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout amen. Look at your neighbor and say, are you in a safe zone or danger zone? Are you in a safe zone or danger zone? Ladies and gentlemen, I love to travel and I love to go to different places. But one of the things that I quickly learned is that everywhere is not like the United States. In the United States, there is regulatory procedures that says that when you're going around a curve, that there are guardrails that are put up similar to the screen, the picture that they will put on the screen. Many of you know what I'm talking about. They have it on the expressway or whenever you're turning a sharp corner. There is a guardrail that keeps the car on the road and from going off a ditch. Because if there is no guardrails, you have the potential of hurting yourself or hurting other individuals. One year I went to Costa Rica and I loved to sleep in the car, but while sleeping, I decided to wake up. And when I decided to wake up, I turned to the right and noticed that we were going up a mountain, and as we were ascending this mountain, there was literally no guardrails. You could look down the side of the mountain, and it was a drop of like 40 feet. They have that picture on the screen that shows similar to what happens when you're traveling a road and do not have any guardrails. This is how some believers are. You're living your life with no guardrails. And where there is no boundaries, where there is nothing that keeps you in line, what ends up happening is you injure yourself or you end up hurting other people. And today, we came so that I can usher you into a safe zone. Many of you have been operating in a danger zone. Look at your neighbor, say, are you in a safe zone or a danger zone? I need you to repeat after me, and I need you to say it like you got strength and like you got power. I need you to say, in light of my past experience, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what is the wisdom of God? Or what is the wise thing to do? That is our thesis statement for the day. I need you to understand, no matter where you are, what you're going through, as an adult and as a believer, your deepest hope and deepest desire is what is the wise thing to do. Because many of us, if we're very honest with ourselves, we don't seek wisdom. We seek convenience. And when you seek convenience, you will literally rob yourself and end up in a danger zone instead of being in a safe zone. So what ends up happening is most of us, when it comes to relationships, we start saying to ourselves, Pastor, I heard what you talked about last week, but I don't know, like, if people really change. There's one writer by the name of John Maxwell that said it like this: people change for a few reasons. Number one, they change when they hurt enough. They change. So when they've experienced enough pain, they done had enough heartbreaks, and they like, I gotta change. Anybody ever been there? I got the fake church today. The second type of people that change is those individuals that see enough and they are inspired to change. You get exposed to something and you're like, oh, now I know that's possible, I'm gonna change. But then you have those individuals that learn enough and then they change. That is my assignment throughout this series, is to make sure that you learn enough so that you can change. Number four, you receive enough and then you change. I need you to look at your neighbors, say, money will make you change. But I got something else for you. Look at them, say, I got something else for you. Being broke will make you change too. Choose ye this day which one you gonna have. But either one of them are going to make you change. But it is important for us to understand that God is not just interested in us crying. He wants us to change. Some of us are great with crying. We can cry on demand, but we don't change at all. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm ready to change. The only reason you came to Transformation Church is because you're ready to change. Why would you come to a church with transformation on the building and not be ready to change? Not be ready to change. There are six signs that I want to give you today of some areas that you need to change, some people you need to change. These individuals are individuals that have soul ties with you. What is a soul tie? These are individuals that I have an emotional, unhealthy attachment with. It is not a spiritual tie. It is a soul tie. When we talk about soul, somebody say soul.
Soul.
I'm speaking of mind, will, and emotion. That means your mind, your will, and your emotion is tied to that thing. Are y'all here? When I speak of spirit, we went over this before. When I speak of spirit, I'm talking about God's spirit. When you have a soul tie, you're connected to them in your mind and your spirit. You're attached to them in your mind, your will, your emotions, and your affections. Somebody say your mind,
your will,
your emotions, and your affections. Everything that you do is tied to them. They're individuals that's under the sound of my voice. You're spiritual, but you got a soul tie. You love God, but you got a soul tie. Can I talk to you for a moment? You got a soul tie, and I know you have a soul tie because you have these individuals around you, or some of you have disconnected with these individuals, and you're still exhibiting these signs. Today, we're just going to go over them, but we're getting ready to have a deliverance service in a few weeks so that we can break this stuff. The first thing, the first reason you know that you have an unhealthy attachment with someone that I like to call a soul tie is, number one, you feel so attached to them that you refuse to cut off connection or set boundaries with them. You know they negative. You know they toxic. You know they not going in the direction that you're going. But you like, you know what? I'm not cutting them off because I'm the only one in the world that knows how to change them. Can I stop and speak to the women for a moment? Are we going to have church or have church? This is for those individuals that are saying to yourselves, I'm going to change him. You can be quiet all day, but you've made up in your mind, I like this because it's a challenge. I'm going to change him. Ma'am, he's a grown man and always been out of order. He ain't gonna get an order for you. People only change when they hurt enough to change. They get enough more to change. We talked about how people change. They're not changing just because you suggest they should change. And many of you are disconnected, but you still connected because you feel in yourself and in your mind, I feel attached to them, so I can't place no boundaries. They can talk to you any kind of way, brother. And you like, they love me. That's why they talk to me like that. Mm-mm. Nasty, rude, disrespectful. Toxic. Ain't no spirit in the world that's gonna make you be mean and nasty. But you have no boundaries, no guardrails with those individuals. Can we have a conversation? You keep allowing them to re-offending and keep doing what they're doing. It's because you have an unhealthy soul tie in your mind, your will, and your emotions. Number two, you left the relationship but still think about them excessively and you can't get over them and you can't get them off your mind. Every time I smell that cologne. Oh, I can't go in that store because every time I smell that cologne, they in my mind. Get them out of your mind. Get her out of your mind. Because what ends up happening is now the mind that should be in you is the one that's in Christ Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I remember I can't drive by that restaurant. I remember when we went in there. Oh. Soul tie. That's got to be the one because, it's got to be the one. Got to be the one. I still feel how he cuts me out. That's the one. No. Soul tie. And if we are not careful, you will start making dysfunction your title and you look for dysfunction in other people. Well, you don't curse me out, So you don't really love me like that. It's going to get tight in here. When the scripture is teaching this, what he's trying to help us to understand, what Paul wants us to understand, is that when a relationship, an opportunity, situation presents itself to us, we're not supposed to just take it, but we are to examine it. Look at it. Think through it. Consider it. We should make sure we assess it to make sure that we're not putting ourselves in a danger zone, but remaining in a safe zone. Some of you are so thirsty that you're willing to drink poison. Thirst can kill you, but poison will kill you faster. It got quiet in here. Being lonely could hurt, but being brokenhearted can kill you. Are y'all here? Having relational issues is one thing. Having relational trauma is a whole nother thing. And if we don't take it and assess it and look at it and discern, not be suspicious, but think it through, how much of this lines up with God's word? Does this look like the nature of God? Is this requiring me to do what God wants me to do? Or is this requiring me to become somebody I'm not? Is this perfecting my character? Is this leading me to God or leading me away from God? Am I always having to compromise, or am I now moving forward in my relationship with God? If this requires you to leave God over here while you go over here, it's probably not from God. It can get quiet in here. But I need you to understand something. When you leave the relationship and you continue to think about them, that is an ungodly soul tie. And you have to consciously, that means decide to break it. I understand the stages of grief. Going through, not acknowledging, you're in denial. Then you go through the season of anger and you go through all of that. But once you've experienced all of that, you've got to decide. You have to decide, bro. You have to decide, sis, I'm moving on. Number three, when you make a decision, and every time you make a decision, you feel like that person is watching you. You have an unhealthy attachment. Well, I'm not going to go out to eat because John, he wouldn't want me to go out to eat by myself, so I'm going to wait till John start talking to me. I'm going to wait till Mary show back up. What if Mary never show back up? You're going to give an account to Jesus that you put your entire life on pause, waiting for somebody to get their mind together? Yeah. Security, please be on standby. Number three, we're just having a conversation today. Number four, I'm going to keep it PG. Kids are outside. But when you have relations, you know how to read. When you have relations, your spouse, it's hard for you to stop thinking or visualizing the other person. Soul tie. Well, I remember this person did that, but this one don't do that like that. Soul tie. Let me stop, get off on this exit, because some of you, you're looking, you're like, you know what, Pastor, you're right. You're right. And then others of you are like, he ain't talking to me. Your soul tie is not that. Your soul tie is the pornography. You can't have a consensual or real relational situation without thinking about the last pornography you watched. This is why pornography is traumatizing. Are y'all here?
Go there, sir. Go there.
We're having adult conversations. Pornography is a traumatizing event that is now vexed almost an entire population. You can have access to it without wanting access to it. You can click on social media and it's readily available to you. You can be having a conversation and one person can say one word that triggers a whole reaction based off of something you've seen. You can hear a sound. You can hear a noise. You can see an outfit. You can see something and it triggers you. Some of you do not have an emotional attachment to people. You have an emotional attachment to pornography. So much so that you cannot intimately be involved with the individuals for real without thinking about pornography. Pornography is a traumatizing event. I want you to imagine, if you will, being hit in the head with the baseball. Traumatizing. It's going to leave a gash. It's going to cut you. It's going to leave some kind of imprint. You're also going to remember every time you get around the baseball field or wherever it happens, you're going to be reminded of it every single time. If pornography is traumatic and traumatizing, every time you watch it, you're doing psychological damage to yourself. Although your body is releasing dopamine and endorphins that release this excitement and makes you feel like, oh my God, I'm having this experience. But the reality is, it is now releasing a chemical imbalance in your body that you're now trying to reproduce in a bed. What you watch an actor do, you now want the real person to do. And wonder why this person can't fake like the person faked on what you watched. It's quiet in here. We're doing surgery today. So now no one can ever satisfy. No one can never satisfy because there is an addiction or a soul tie to this thing called pornography. You visualizing. It's on your mind. You have to take yourself away from the normal people. You will interrupt your day, be late to things just to get involved with it. It's an addiction. It's a soul tie. You will cancel appointments. I can't make it today. Because your favorite person just decided they wanted to release new content.
Come on, sir.
PG. And the Bible makes it very clear that we need to examine. And sometimes you might not have those problems, but you're linking up with people that do. And before you know it, you're trying to do what they're doing. And your satisfaction can't come from any other way but that way. Look at your neighbor, say, you're better than that. You're better than that. Break the tie. Break the tie. Break the tie. Break the tie. Number five, you take on negative traits of the person your soul is tied to and carry out their offenses whether you agree or not. In other words, I don't like them because they didn't like them. They ain't never do nothing to you, but I don't like them because they ain't like them. I got a problem with them because they had a problem with them. Soul tie. Soul tie. I don't deal with them because they don't deal with them. They didn't deal with them. Soul tie. Number six, you defend your right to stay in a relationship with them even though it negatively affects and destroys other important relationships in your life. You stay with them and can't even talk to your mama. What you said? You stay with them and can't even take care of your children. You chose the person more than your kids. Look straight ahead. Nobody will know. Do you think God blessed you with children? We talking today. Blessed you with children. You was having that baby shower, sitting in that big throne chair. Like, this is, bring me all the gifts. Bring me all the gifts. We done ate all the meatballs and potato salad we can have. You got the crown on your head. Taking all the pictures, and now you done met somebody else. Throw the big chair away. Y'all take care of yourself. I'm over here. God sent me the one. He sent you the one, but you're now denying the blessing?
My God, help somebody.
Are we here? But the reality is that we have ungodly soul ties with people, and it impacts us, and we not understand why it's impacting us. I need you to understand these four levels of intimacy today. There's four levels of intimacy today. Timothy, the scripture I read, the book in Timothy, he says, listen, he says, people going to show up all kinds of ways. I need y'all to hear me. He says, people going to show up all kinds of ways. They're going to be liars. They're going to be slanderers. They're going to be all types of people. So there's going to be all types of people. There's going to be all types of people that's going to come in, and they're going to have all kinds of agendas. And he says, they're going to dress up being religious. And he says, the way that you're going to know them is by getting a relationship with God. This is what Timothy is saying in this particular scripture. Hear me. They name some of everybody we know, and they even name some of who we can be. No truthful people in church today. Say, Pastor, I done come a long way, but I've been on that list before. But there are some individuals that are still on that list with no intentions of changing, no intentions of changing. And you're now committing to when the scripture tells us to run from. It says, leave those individuals. It says, leave those individuals. There's four levels of intimacy, and I need you to understand them. Number one is acquaintance. We all know acquaintance. We know what that is. These are people that we just talk to or casual with. Number two, then there are associates. You go to church with me. You love God. I love God. You like to shout and dance. I like to shout and dance. We're associates. And then there are individuals. There are individuals that are our friends. These are individuals that have consistent interaction with us on a day-to-day basis. And then there are spouses. Most of us are good with acquaintance and spouses. We know exactly who they are. But we're unclear on who is an associate versus who is a friend. And if you're not careful, you will drag boundaries, guardrails. You will drag associates into the friend category. And some of you got too much God. Instead of using guardrails, you keep using chalk. I wish I had some chalk right now. You will draw a boundary, and depending on who it is, you erase it and move it further. And God is trying to say the reason why you keep having these issues in your life is because you keep getting after the same people with a different name that has the same attribute. They're all crazy. They're all doing what they do. They all love you for the first 3 months. Then the next 4 months, it turns sour. And then the next 6 months, y'all hate each other. And then y'all get back together and say, whoa, this is God. And God is trying to say in this season of your life, you've got to learn to seek the wisdom of God. Is there anybody in this room that says, I'm not trying to do anything outside of God's will? I want to have God's peace, so I'm going to do it God's way. Is there a screamer that can open up your mouth in this room and say, I want to do my life God's way? Tired of living in cycles. It's tired of living in cycles. You keep meeting the same person, going through the same cycle. It's the reason why you're doing that is because you keep pulling people from the same pond. You keep grabbing your associates and putting them in the friend zone before they're supposed to be in the friend zone. And whenever people are unclassified appropriately, what ends up happening is you end up scarring them, hurting them, giving them information that they cannot handle. Some people cannot handle the things that have happened in your life. And you've got to have discernment to know that you got to stay as an associate. You can't be my friend. Is there anybody in this room that can be honest in this room and say, there's some stuff I just can't tell y'all. There's some places I just can't go with you. There's some things I just can't do with you. Associates and friends and people that are lonely are willing to put anybody anywhere and wonder why it doesn't work out. I need you to lift those hands and say, Lord, deliver me from every space of loneliness in my life, every loneliness in my career, every loneliness in my church, any loneliness in my love life, loneliness in my business life, loneliness in any area of my life, because it's not just subjected to just being in it's not just subjected to being in an intimate relationship. You can be lonely in business practices, and now you want to go do business with people that are not integrous. You can be lonely in ministry. There have been seasons of my life where I'm saying, God, why can't I be with them? Why can't I run with them? And one day we were talking to my pastor, and my pastor came back from this huge assignment. It was like one of his first, like, huge, huge assignment with thousands of people. And he came back and he sat us down and he said, you don't want to be up there. I said, what? I said, they are on the plane every week going to church. Says, you don't want to be up there. I looked at him and said, no, he jealous. Y'all know how it is when you don't know anybody. I was like, no, he jealous. Then he responded and he said, he did it like this. He said, some of that stuff is unhealthy. It's a good show for 45 minutes, but it's unhealthy outside of that. He says, you don't want to be up there. He says, I don't want to be up there. He said it like this. He says, I refuse to be in front of people, and my marriage is raggedy. And he began to go down the line. And it began to show me that you can be in a safe zone or you can be in a danger zone. And if you put people in the wrong place, you'll end up destroying their lives or destroying your lives. One more I didn't add for the first service. I'm going to add it right now. Some of y'all are making your assignment your friend. My job was to get your information and get close to you so I could minister to you. Not for me to hang out. Not for me to get buddy-buddy. Not for you to be my smoke partner. Not for you to be my drink partner. I'm on an assignment to bring you out. Are y'all in this room? Or if you're not careful, you'll end up dating an assignment. Oh, they love me. They love me. No, they're drawn to the anointing that was meant to destroy the yoke that is off of their life. And I need somebody to open up your mouth like you're getting ready to walk in the wisdom of God like never before. Like you're not finna mix up your life. You're not finna throw away your boundaries. But you're getting ready to establish where people should go. That's like saying every friendly coworker is called to be my wife. Look at your neighbor and say, not everybody can just be with me. Not everybody could just be with me. We're getting ready to go. I need to keep you from crashing. I need to keep you from crashing. I need to keep you from crashing. Look down your row, say, I need to keep you from crashing. You can't have another accident. You can't destroy another piece of your life. You cannot afford to be going back to court again. You can't afford to be losing more of your paycheck again. You cannot get in another situation like that again. You cannot afford to be taking pills because you got anxiety about what they're going to do. You cannot be in a place where your heart is broken, where you're now having to drink yourself into a place of peace. I need somebody to open your mouth and say, I can't crash again. I can't crash again. I can't go down like that again. I cannot let the enemy use me like that again. I gotta use my discernment in this season. Is there anybody in this room that can say, I made enough mess in my life, but now I need God's help? I done chose the wrong people many times, but I need God's help. Is there a screamer that can open your mouth in this room and say, God, I'm ready to pick the right one. I'm ready to go to the right place. I'm ready to do the right thing. I can't sit back and sit down. I can't disrupt any more of my life. My children had to suffer for my bad decision. My loved ones had to suffer for my bad decisions. My career had to suffer for my bad decision. But is there anybody in here that can praise God for 30 seconds because he preserved you in the middle of your crazy actions? He preserved you in the middle of your accidents. He preserved you in the seasons and the times that they tried to hinder you and stop you from doing what God called you to do. I need you to take 30 seconds and praise God. Like you know it was God that shielded and protected you. I said, this one is on you. I want you to praise him that you didn't lose your mind, that you didn't lose your heart, that you didn't give up in the middle. Shake your neighbor by the hand, holler at him and say, neighbor, I'm not trying to be funny, but this is personal. I could have been dead, sleeping in my grave, but God rescued me.
Is there anybody here that's ever been rescued by God? If you've been rescued by him, I tell you to open your mouth and shout. Can you thank God that Bozo left when he did? Can you thank God that Miss Crazy left when she did? We in church, can we tell the truth? Can we tell the truth? Can we tell the truth? But if we're not careful, we will crash because there's no guardrails. And when there's no guardrails, we end up in a danger zone and not a safe zone. I need you to discern where you are. If you're in a safe zone or are you in a danger zone? I know what you're trying to make other people think you're in, but what are you really in? Y'all ever had one of those relationships that you was praying and you know it was over and you're talking about, God, show me a sign. Show me a sign. Pastor, get up, say, leave, leave, leave. You say, God, show me a sign. Show me a sign. Pastor was off today. I didn't feel the anointing. Show me a sign. Praise and worship team, bow down and worship him. You know, they off today. Show me a sign. You get to the stop sign and stop. You turn the TV on. Stop. You on your way to their house, get a flat tire. Like, show me a sign, God. You want a camel to walk in your bedroom with a red handkerchief to show you a sign. The next sign you're going to see is going to be the stop sign falling on top of you. How many more signs you need? How many more signs you need? I mean, I remember doing that, going to God. I'm finna fast today. Done lost all the way. Show me, is this the one? Show me, is this the one? He done spoke, left. You don't feel nothing. And you're talking, rekindle. We got to fight through this. No. He gave you the exit sign. One more time, God. This time it's going to work. It's going to work. I'm changing my phone number. It's going to work. You doing all of that. And the season have passed. And you keep wrecking out and keep crashing because you're ignoring the signs and the signals. Some of y'all there right now. Show me a sign. Show me a sign. Show me a sign. Show me a sign. You get $100. Oh, that's it. That's it. That is it. God, I thank you. Yes, Lord, you speaking today. Mm-mm. Y'all think that God speaks and it's all going to bring you joy. Sometimes when God speaks, it brings you heartache. That's going to lead you to joy. It's going to give you peace. Number one, I need to give you 7 indicators to keep you from crashing. And we're getting ready to go. Number one, I need you to regularly evaluate the core group of friends that surround you. Make sure they headed in the same direction. Some of us want to be in relationship and travel with people that ain't even got the same mission as us. And much of your life and the reason you keep going to bed tired is not because you're doing anything, but it's because you're thinking about how I'm going to get them to do what I'm doing. How can I drag them to be progressive and go back to college and go get their education and do better for themselves? And you ain't even thinking about what you should be doing for you. You forgot about your vision because you're so busy dragging. Come on. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. If I got to do that, you are an assignment. You are an assignment. Please stop drinking. Please stop drinking. You are an assignment. You're an assignment. Second thing, when you feel the pressure to become someone that you're not, you need to rethink that relationship. Every time you get around them, you got to start cussing and you never curse. You got to start arguing and you don't even argue. You know what? I'm mad for no reason, just because they always mad for no reason. Raising your voice, getting mad for no reason. Number three, when you hope the people you care about most don't know about your whereabouts. You heard what I just said?
When you hope the people that care about you don't know about your whereabouts. These people are now bringing you an environment that you wouldn't want your loved ones to know about. What? You ain't never have to hide to come to church. Never did. But you done threw on an extra wig because now they dragging you in the script club. Dark shades. Trying to not be seen at the party that you know you don't normally be at. Like, oh, I'm the, some of my church people might be there. I can't go there. You know, transformation, I don't like it because, you know, some of everybody go there. They be in your business. Nobody don't even know you like that. Number four, the wise see all of life as connected. A fool sees everything as disconnected. A fool thinks nothing don't mean nothing. Everything is connected. If you drag me, and these are boundaries we all have to set personally. If you drag me to a script club, you'll drag me to hell. If you drag me into a lie, you'll drag me to jail. Because there's no boundaries. There's no guardrails. You're in a danger zone. It's quiet. Y'all all right? If you lie on your income tax, what he just said, you will lie on a PPP loan. Somebody say, did. I must have heard it in the spirit. But you need to disconnect. You need to disconnect. Number five, there's safety in numbers. When you know what you come with, you got to set certain boundaries. If you know that you're promiscuous, if you know that, hey, it don't take much, there's safety in numbers. Do not ride in a car with the opposite sex by yourself if you know you can't handle it. Did y'all hear what I just said? If you know you can't handle it, stop setting up meetings to meet with people and to do things that you know gonna trigger you. There's certain people I don't even make eye contact with. I see your spirit a mile away. You came ready. I'm not playing with you today. Can we be truthful? A lady got in my inbox. She got in my inbox. Say, I feel the Lord is leading us to be friends. I say, go to God. I get deep and spiritual real quick. Shut it down. Somebody, oh, you look amazing. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. They say that man's so spiritual. No way. You got to know how to set boundaries. Set boundaries. One lady was, I was preaching. She was like, really, she could have been my mom. And she says, you know, Pastor, I just, you know, I love your preaching and, you know, it just does something to me. I said, glory to God. She said, but you not understand. I said, glory to God. She said, but you, I'm being serious. I said, glory to God. She said, the Lord said, my next husband going to be a prophet, apostle. I said, I ain't neither one of them. Start speaking in tongues. You have to say. Set your boundaries. Set your boundaries. Pastor, can I call you after 10 o'clock? No, ma'am. No. No. Well, what? If somebody's dying, call me. If they not, I'm going to ask you, why are you calling me this late? You got to establish boundaries. Number six, we are acceptance magnets. Therefore, relentlessly guard your heart.
We have to relentlessly guard your heart. You have to guard your heart. The Bible says because out of it flows the issues of life. You have to guard your heart. You have to guard your heart. Because if not, we're acceptance people. Anything that comes, hey, must be God. Hey, must be God. Hey, must be God. Do you know that the enemy can also send distractions your way? I've never met a distraction I didn't like. I never met a distraction I did not like. Every distraction looks, feel, and seem like everything that I want it to be. I've never seen a distraction on a menu that did not have what I did not like. Did you hear what I just said? Satan makes a menu off of stuff that he has studied about you. And then he brings it and say, I'm going to just leave that right there. I ain't going to make no noise. Leave that right there. It's going to sit right there. She likes somebody that look like this, that do this, that's like that. Right there. Sit back. Just watch. Don't do nothing. Don't say nothing. Just watch. Just watch. And sometimes it's a year. Sometimes it's 2 years. Sometimes it's 5 years. Be 10, 15 years. Set it right there. It's on the menu. Just wait. Just wait. It's like a lion. I love to watch National Geographic. The lions study its prey. They don't just go out there and just growl, roaring just to roar. It doesn't just go out there. That's why the Bible describes it. Says he's coming like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He comes in, he studies, comes to your church. Somebody here right now studying you. I want to see when she yell. I want to see when she holler. I want to see what makes her react. I want to slide by, like that dress, like that hairdo. Like that. Yep. Very good. That's amazing. Next thing you know, it's, I like that. I'm not suggesting that people cannot meet in church. That's not what I'm suggesting. But I am suggesting that the enemy will utilize it as a space. I think that there's been amazing couples that's been created at church. So I'm not suggesting that you cannot meet someone at church. But I need you to also be privy that there are individuals that has a scorpion spirit that studies you, and they know you better than you know you. They know when you down. They know when you up. And then, like the lion, waits to its prey. It's in a vulnerable place, and then it's over. And oftentimes, it does not happen. It does not happen when you're strong, because you can shut it down. It happens when you're weak, when you're vulnerable. And this is why we cannot glory when someone falls. This is why this will never be a graceless church. Because the Bible says, lest you be overtaken yourself. That's why we have to be quick to restore. Because there are people that may fall into sin. We need to be quick to restore them. Don't point fingers at me. I told you. I knew you was. No. You help them up because you could be next. Because the same enemy that was praying and watching them is watching you. And they may be watching them as far as a man, but it could be money or an opportunity that's watching you. Are y'all in this room? That's why it never registered to me how church people can be so excited when someone falls. That's wicked. That's wicked. It just, I don't understand it. I never understood it. There are people that plays vloggers to destroy people's lives. And the church finances it. I said it. The church are the ones that's watching it. It's because you don't recognize that you too can fall into the same thing. And it might not be the same way that they fell. Last thing, when you hear yourself say, I'll go, but I won't participate. You're probably not supposed to be there. I need you to understand something. This series, we're doing heart surgery.
jumping, shouting, yelling, hollering, encouragement, there's a time for that. But this is the time we got to do heart surgery. There are many of you that are under the sound of my voice today that literally say to yourself, he's talking to me. And I recognize these indicators, and there are some changes that need to be made. Whenever we're brought into this type of revelation, it's because God loves us so much that he wants us to course correct so that we don't drive off the side of a ditch. I tell all my brothers in the room, or any of them that are connected with me, I tell them, I watch you. You're doing a lot of kiki-kiing. Get out of her face. And my daughters, I tell you, doing a lot of. Because after the kiki, you end up putting people in the wrong space. And then the place that gets the damage is the church and you. Well, Pastor, always watching. I don't miss much. I don't miss much. Kiki-kiing. And entire kingdoms have been brought down because wrong people were put in the wrong place. And you don't think the enemy would try to disrupt the move of God by doing the same thing? I need you to ask yourself, are you in a safe zone or a danger zone? Are you in a safe zone or are you in a danger zone? I want everybody standing on your feet. Because loneliness has a way of pushing us to make decisions and put people in wrong places. But I need you to understand that you are not abandoned. And you're not without. I'm not up here preaching this because I've done all right. I'm able to preach this because I've learned from a lot of these mistakes. I don't want you to ever believe or be led to believe that anything that I preach is because I have perfected. But I only preach out of my own convictions. If I can't preach it with sincerity, I'm not preaching it. And these are things that I need you to help. I need you to understand clearly. This is not an exhaustive list. That means it ain't everything. But it's some things that you should be on watch for. And if we ever get relationships like this right, horizontal, it'll be easy to get vertical relationships right. Some of the most gifted people, most talented and anointed preachers and pastors and evangelists and singers, are not where they needed to be because they got connected to someone that wasn't supposed to be where they put them. And my heart breaks today because I understand the value of relationships. And I understand what happens when wrong people are put in the wrong place. So today, there are those of you that have soul ties that need to be broken. We're going to have a deliverance service specifically for that. Because you can never get in a new relationship as long as you're tied in that old one. I'm not suggesting, I'm not talking about those that are grieving that's coming from long-term marriages. There is a space of grief. There's a place of transition. I'm not speaking of that. I'm speaking of those individuals that are literally going from one relationship to the next relationship, and you keep carrying the first person into all of these relationships and trying to get them to become who the first person was. That's who I'm talking to. And God is ready to break those strongholds. So, Father, today as we pray for my brother and my sister that you'd give us the power to execute everything that was said today. Help us to stay in a safe zone and not a danger zone. Don't let us be so mesmerized by people that we are willing to leave you instead of following you. God, we pray today that as we have heard this word, seal it in our hearts that we might not sin against you. Father, every place that we have been wrong or places that we can do better, assist us through your Holy Spirit. Father, give us discernment. Sharpen our discernment. We're ready to follow your way. We're ready to follow your voice. Speak, Lord, and we will listen. Guide us, and we will go. We give your name the praise, and we give your name the honor and the glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. With head bows, eyes closed, if you're in this building and you're not where you need to be with God, if there's some things that separated you from God, if you say, God,